I invite the first speaker, Dr. Anu Jun is there. P.P. Singh. Okay. Is there? Yeah.
6 minutes.
So I request all the speakers to stick to the time.
Good morning, everybody. So I'm here with you to share our experience on portable fundus camera on phone. The rationale behind this study was that glaucoma, as you know, is going to affect 80 million people by 2020. It's going to be a healthcare problem. Since structural changes in optic disc can be an effective screening tool because IOP and visual field and gonia are not feasible as screening tools, and there's a dearth of trained professionals for screening, artificial intelligence tools are a viable option and they are being explored. And a recent study by Harvard on 186 patients launched their Pegasus Disc AI. And now, we were lucky enough to be a part of the Made in India generic AI, which comes to the rescue for this. And this was a portable fundus on phone, we call it FOP now. And our aim of the study was to validate this. The methods were consecutive glaucoma cases referred to glaucoma clinic. The benefit was it's a non-vitreoretic fundus evaluation was done by trained glaucoma fellows after informed consent. The methods were basically we were validating against standard protocol of 90D examination vis-a-vis a non-vitreoretic FOP generic made by Remedio Innovations. I have no financial interest to declare. Examination protocol was ambient light, non-vitreoretic pupils. Disc image was captured by trained technicians from Remedio Innovations using the FOP. Then the image review and classification was done by glaucoma experts using rubrics provided by DDLS scale or disc damage likelihood scale or Dr. Spaeth. And they were divided into mild, moderate or severe glaucoma or no or suspect glaucoma. Then comparative 90D disc examination was done by the same examiner, thus obviating examiner bias. And they noted similarities or difference in the two methods. More than one difference of DDLS was significant. And they noted causes of poor image acquisition. So the results were, we had 53 patients of 103 eyes. Age range was from 12 to 72 years. Mean was 49 years. Diagnosis ranged from dissuspects, OAG, ACG, normal tension glaucomas, and secondary glaucomas. And few also were non-glaucomatous discs, like disc coloboma, which were referred to glaucoma clinic. Image clarity is this picture you can see on the left is the image clarity. Clear scans were obtained in 81% of the eyes. Hazy scan was seen in 9 eyes, and the common cause is media opacities. And non-acquisition was seen in 11 eyes. Again, the cause was advanced cataract, meiosis, advanced pterygium, corneal edema, and silicone oil. Now, in these patients where the scans were hazy or non-acquired, 90D came to the rescue in 7 eyes, it could see. However, in 2 eyes, even that could not see very well. And in the other eyes where no non-acquisition was there, disc was very faintly seen in 8 eyes of 90D also. Therefore, analyzing these, there was a congruency that same grade was there in the DDLS scale between FOP and 90D in 75% eyes. Underestimation was there in 9.7 and overestimation was there in 1.9. And since there was no acquisition in some eyes, it was not applicable in 13% eyes. Discrepancy was there of more than one grain 50%, and disc photograph was not captured in 13% eyes. This is the hazy. This is how we did the grading afterwards. So on comparing the two things, in no glaucoma, FOP slightly overestimated that no functional damage eyes, 63 vis-a-vis 60% of the 90D. Mild glaucoma and moderate to advanced, it underestimated the advanced ones, like a mild one, 12 to 15, 14%, moderate 3 versus 4%, and advanced 11 vis-a-vis 16%. The problems we encountered were hazy media and disc pallor was found to be a confounder. So we analyzed disc. These are the images by FOP, all of them. And in these 3 eyes with pallor, one eye had a similar grade with DDLS, one eye was doubtful. And one eye, 90D could make out that it was a glaucomatous pallor, which FOP could not. So in conclusion, what we think is the diagnostic dilemmas were disc pallor is better diagnosed with 90D. we had some limitations, small sample size, it was a pilot project, and there was no masking because that wasn't feasible since the same examiner was done to obviate observer bias. Conclusions, it's a rapid tool, short learning curve, undiluted pupil view is very much feasible, amenable to analysis, 80% congruency, however it does underestimate advanced disc damage, overestimate no functional damage, poor image acquisition is there in hazy media, and diagnostic issues in disc pallor. Advantages are these, it's a fast, portable, can be done in supine patients and young patients, which we did not do. And ultimately, it will ease the load on trained specialists. It's a welcome option. And for telemedicine and for taking up algorithm to pick up GDD, it's a very reliable tool. And it's going to be, it's made in India, so it's benefit of that. Thank you. And to quote the Asimov series of Bicentennial Man, where artificial intelligence is going to take up normal intelligence, we have to remember that we have to be very wise in deciding which AI is going to replace the trained glaucoma specialist. Therefore, these studies which have come up of in DR, they haven't come up in glaucoma yet. They have been validation of AI in glaucoma is going to be the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kirti. Any questions? You want to ask any questions? We move to the next free paper that is going to be presented by Dr. Suman Lata, Comparative Evaluation of ASOCT, UBM and IOP after PRP by Pascal or Conventional Laser in Diabetic Retinopathy. Then we move to the next presentation by Dr. Gunjan Deshpande. Is the presenter here? She would be presenting a paper entitled Linear Discriminant Score for Differentiating Early POAG from Suspects.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for accepting my work. It is titled Linear Discriminant Differentiating Early POAG from Suspects. It is not moving ahead. It's not moving ahead. I have no financial disclosures to make. As we all know, glaucoma is characterized by loss of retinal ganglion cells, corresponding visual field defects, and retinal nerve fiber layer loss. It is interesting to know that more than 50% of all these retinal ganglion cells are concentrated and are multi-layered at the macula. Therefore, this renewed interest in studying the macula for early diagnosis of glaucoma. There are recent articles that have analyzed combination of these structural processes. As we know, the RNFL, can I have a pointer? Yeah. The RNFL and the GCC, they have been studied individually, and with the best of our knowledge, this is the first work done in Indian population where we have combined the RNFL and the GCC parameters. We wanted to determine the diagnostic ability of a linear discriminant function in discriminating suspects from early glaucoma and also validating this LDF using an independent test sample. This was a cross-sectional observational study in which we took a complete visual evaluation, cyclopegic refraction, detailed straight line examination, intraocular pressure measurement, gonioscopy, dilated fundus examination, and the Humphreys visual field 24-2 CETA standard. The OCT procedure was carried out using Cirrus OCT after pupillary dilation by a single operator. Excluded were images with a signal strength less than 5, lost data, motion artifacts, or segmentation artifacts. These are the parameters this was studied: GCC, supranasal, superior, superotemporal, inferonasal, inferior among the others, and ONH and RNFL, average thickness, rim area, and the others. This is how we have defined early glaucoma, defined as according to the Patella and Anderson criteria. Mean deviation had to be less than minus 6 decibels. This is important to know that we did not want to differentiate normal from early glaucoma. We wanted to differentiate suspects from early glaucoma. And suspects were defined as patients who had no history of any ocular disease, pressure is normal. Glaucomatous appearing disc, however, had a normal perimetrian OCT. patients who had media opacity, macular pathology, or any color visual disturbances or any medication that could affect the visual field were excluded. These are the statistical analysis used. We had studied a total of 201 eyes, of which 127 were suspect and 74 were POAG. We found that the age and the signal strength had varied significantly, and therefore they were adjusted before doing any further analysis, as seen over here. Also, luckily, we could see that the disc area also had not varied significantly. What we found at the end was the inferotemporal parameter was the best. The inferotemporal quadrant was the best performing parameter for GCC, and these are the given LDF equations. For the ONH and the RNFL, we had average RNFL thickness and the vertical CDR, and the combined LDF, which used the average RNFL thickness, vertical CDR, and minimal and superior GCIPLs. What we found was that when we computed the AUROC, the GCC performed at 0.81. The ONH RLFL performed at 0.903. However, the combined LDF had a better AORC of 0.924. When we validated this using a test set, we found that the specificity and the sensitivity both were high, and the accuracy was as good as 84%. We all know that the GCC ONH RNFL have been used for detection of early damage on OCTs. However, the parameters are numerous, and therefore they're very difficult to interpret the combinative data that is given to us. RGC assessment, as I've said, 50% lie in GCC, lie in the macular area, and nearly 100% at the RNFL. Therefore, they present a potential combination for targeting different neuroretinal areas. LDF has been known to be an established consideration, has been known to be used previously. As I said before, this is the first Indian study to have formulated an LDF. It's a multivariable model which integrates multiple parameters into a single entity, and also helps us in classification of patients. There were a few notable studies, especially by LaRosa et al., Huang et al., and Midros et al. These are the given parameters that they studied. There are a few differences in the form of color coding. LaRosa et al. Used color codes. However, color codes will differ with each version and with each type of OCT that is being used. Huang et al. Also used demographic factors like age, sex, and race. Race, however, is not applicable in our setup. And Midros et al. Had used moderate and advanced glaucoma, and we did not use moderate and advanced glaucoma cases because there was a possibility of high skewing. As I've said earlier, key controls were used and not normal patients, because differentiating between normal and glaucoma was easier rather than differentiating suspects from glaucoma. And these patients were glaucomatous clinically, however, had a normal perimetry in OCT. Inclusion of suspects, again, had reduced our specificity, of course, because the true negatives were reduced, therefore the specificity had reduced. And also, because we had excluded moderate and advanced glaucomas, therefore the sensitivity also had reduced. However, we wanted it to be more specific towards the glaucoma suspect patients. We have few limitations that our study is not applicable to moderate advanced glaucomas, normal tension glaucoma, angle closures, and high myopia patients. Also, the diagnostic ability is expected to be low for PPG patients, because we included only those patients who had a positive visual field loss. And only good quality scans were considered, which may not always be the way in clinical practice. Now, I would like to conclude that GCC and these other structural parameters have comparable diagnostic value. The LDF always increases our diagnostic value and allows us external validation. Thank you. These are my references. Thank you.
So there's a request, please. All the speakers must mention their name, membership number when you do introduce yourself, please.
Your number, please. AOS number.
Number. Membership number.
Okay.
Okay. You're a member of the list.
I'm a member.
Relative. Yeah, that's what was required. Thank you.
Madam, we did not
ocular hypertensives. We hardly had 3 or 4 cases.
The question is why have it as an issue? The question is the question is why did you exclude it? Even if there were 2 or 3, because that would have added to the probability of POG. Just one little point there, when you're talking of suspects, OHD is very much part of the glaucoma suspect. That's one. And secondly, the problem with the GCC is that it's topographically important. So sometimes when you have the RNFL defect exactly at the poles, then the ganglion cell loss goes beyond the annulus.
Yes, ma'am.
And it will be normal. So many times, in fact, including both could be counterproductive because you would falsely miss out on glaucomas with poles. Conversely, if it's closer, that's why with some glaucoma suspects now you'd like to do 10-2.
Yes,
if it's closer to the papillomacular bundle, then you will have early macular loss, which is what NTG is, but you might not have an RNFL defect because the normal RNFL in that is pretty thick.
Yes, ma'am.
So sometimes, whenever you write this up, include this, that the limitation is that you have not taken into account topography of damage. And that's why. The second point is, how would you expect NDF to be used clinically?
Madam, we had thought of making, an application kind of a thing, and for further external validation, because the group that we used were, I mean, we had 45 eyes in the validation set.
I assume it is valid. How do I use it clinically?
Ma'am, if we can use it in a larger population, maybe we'll be able to find, the application would have been larger. And of course, we need a software backup because we need to make an application. I mean, we are planning to make an application out of it.
The next speaker is weak corneal biomechanics.
Yeah, is weak corneal biomechanics a biomarker for glaucoma in eyes with pseudoexfoliation? And the presenter is Dr. Zia Sultan Pradhan. I'm sorry, it's Divya Kesarwani, yeah. It's a corneal biomechanics in connective tissue disorders. That's right, it's the next, paper 4. Paper 4. This is correct.
Please mention your AIOS number. Good afternoon, everybody. My AIOS number is D15756. So I'll be presenting about corneal biomechanics and connective tissue disorders. These are a group of multi-system diseases characterized by chronic inflammation of organs rich in connective tissue such as skin, joints, and eyes, usually due to immune dysregulation. Collagen as a part of connective tissue richly found in eyes and particularly in cornea might be affected in connective tissue disorder ultrastructurally even without clinical ophthalmic involvement. Now this is the machine which we have used in our study, ocular response analyzer, which measures intraocular pressure, corneal compensated and Goldman correlated, and various corneal biomechanical properties like corneal hysteresis, which is a measure of viscous dampening of cornea and its ability to absorb and disseminate energy. Corneal resistance factor, which is a resistance factor for deformation of cornea. Corneal biomechanical properties have been shown to be affected in patients with glaucoma in earlier studies and are important to consider when measuring intraocular pressure. Earlier studies have evaluated the corneal biomechanical properties using ORA in rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, systemic sclerosis, collagen vascular diseases with various conflicting results. Ours is the first study with the highest number of participants with connective tissue disorder in which corneal biomechanical properties have been studied. So we proceeded with the aim to evaluate the corneal biomechanical properties in patients with connective tissue disorder and compare them with age-matched healthy control. We took 62 diagnosed cases of connective tissue disorder who were already on treatment from immunology department, and they were enrolled from January 17 to July 18. 44 subjects formed the age match healthy control group without connective tissue disorder. All participants enrolled were more than 18 years and were free from any ophthalmic and systemic diseases. We excluded all those ophthalmic corneal conditions which affected the corneal stroma and hence its lamellar arrangement, which led to malformed biomechanical properties like corneal ectasia, keratitis, dystrophy or degeneration, or vascularization. Diabetes mellitus, any previous intraocular surgery like refractive surgery or corneal cross-linking. Glaucoma and high IOP also. Only one eye, right eye of the subject was enrolled in the study. All participants underwent comprehensive ophthalmic examination, including BCV, IOP fundus examination. Ocular response analyzer and corneal pachymetry measurements were performed. All subjects were assessed for corneal hysteresis, resistance factor, corneal compensated IOP, Goldman correlated IOP, and central corneal thickness. 5 measurements were obtained for each eye, and the average of these measurements was taken as a final reading. Now we came to results. As we can see here, only significant values were seen in the steroid treatment group in the study group, and there was no significant association in the mean age and the gender of the patients. These are the various clinical diagnoses of connective tissue disorders which we included in our study. Majority were rheumatoid arthritis followed by SLE and sarcoidosis. Rest of these diseases formed equal contribution. Now this is our main result table, where we can see that the mean corneal hysteresis value was 9.54 plus minus 1.66, and mean corneal resistance factor value was 9.95 plus minus 1.47. These both values were statistically significantly lower in the study group than the control group. And we also got significant values in the central corneal thickness, which was higher in the study group than the control group. Now coming to the discussion part, these biomechanical properties are highly important to consider in connective tissue disorders when the patient is planned for refractive surgery and measuring IOP. We reported significantly lower CH and CRF in our patients with CTDs with comparable Goldman correlated IOP and corneal biomechanical corneal compensated IOP. So these are the various studies. In this study by Coloco et al, 2014, 23 patients of collagen vascular disease had no significant difference in mean CH and CRF. Whereas in another study of 29 patients by Emery et al, with scleroderma showed higher CRF and Goldman correlated IOP but comparable CH. This is a similar study to our study. Yazici et al studied corneal biomechanical properties in 30 patients with SLE and found that mean CH and mean CRF and Goldman correlated IOP was statistically significantly lower compared to the control group. So we can say that these lower CH is associated with various types of glaucoma, including POAG, PACG, normal tension, and pseudoexfoliative glaucoma. Lower CH is also associated with glaucomatous visual field and optic nerve progression. So to conclude all this, we can say that lower CH found in our patient with CTD may underestimate the IOP that may have clinical implication in the diagnosis and management of glaucoma. And so this study highlights the importance of corneal biomechanical properties in connective tissue disorders. Thank you.
You did not correlate it with intraocular pressure. I mean, actually check the Goldman intraocular pressure.
No, we routinely did that Goldman intraocular pressure, that GAD, but we had not used as a comparative tool in this study.
So you have not compared readings with the ORA with the actual?
No, not that.
And the other thing is, remember the corneal biomechanics are not just influenced by the IOP, but it is also a cause of the IOP being lower.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
so
ma'am.
What Dr. Preeti said has a lot of sense, that if you measure the intraocular pressure, sometimes when the IOP is high, the CH is low.
Yes, ma'am.
And we don't know whether the CH is low, therefore the pressure recorded is high, or because the pressure is high, the CH recorded is low.
Because of that, the CH is low.
So without intraocular pressure data, just talking of biomechanics, because remember the corneal compensated IOP and Goldman corrected IOP include that in the measurement. So if it's a function of the statistics, not having an intraocular pressure is not going to be able to, you're not going to be able to say that the CH is low per se. I would say that the CH is low because in connective tissue disorders, the cornea is more rigid and the IOP measured is higher.
Okay.
Which is what you're showing.
We have not compared, ma'am. Yeah. Yes.
No, you excluded, no? You excluded cases of glaucoma.
We excluded glaucoma patients.
You say that's that our exclusion criteria. Yeah, so you should present that, that after excluding patients with high IOP, we took a cohort of whatever connective tissue disorder.
Thank you, ma'am.
Shall we move on to the next paper? That's paper five. Is weak corneal biomechanics a biomarker for glaucoma in eyes with pseudoexfoliation? And presenter is Dr. Zia Sultan Pardhan.
Good afternoon. This is my AIOS membership number, P13884. So our research question was, is weak corneal biomechanics a biomarker for glaucoma in eyes with pseudoexfoliation? So pseudoexfoliation is a condition characterized by abnormal fibrillar deposits in the eye, and it increases the risk of glaucoma. However, not all eyes with pseudoexfoliation develop glaucoma, and there's an insufficient data on what factors confer this increased risk. Therefore, our hypothesis was, amongst eyes with pseudoexfoliation, those with weaker corneal biomechanics may increase the risk of glaucoma. To test this hypothesis, we use the Corvus ST, which records the entire dynamic reaction of the cornea to a fixed air impulse as shown in this video. It's basically an NCT to which they've attached a Scheimpflug camera. Besides measuring the IOP and the CCT, it also provides us with certain biomechanical parameters as shown here. As the cornea moves inwards, we get the first applanation point where we can calculate the velocity of the cornea as well as the length of the applanated area. It then continues to move inwards and becomes concave. And at the peak concavity, that is the highest concavity, we have three parameters: the deformation amplitude, which is the total distance moved of the corneal apex from the start to this highest concavity point in millimeters; the peak distance, which is the distance between the two corneal bending points; and the radius of curvature shown here in the figure. The cornea then resumes its original convex position, and it goes through an A2, an applanation 2 phase, where again velocity and length are calculated. Having described this background, I'll now go on to our study, whose objective was to compare the corneal biomechanical parameters between eyes with pseudoexfoliation glaucoma, pseudoexfoliation syndrome, and normalized using Corvus ST. This was a prospectively planned cross-sectional study. We excluded eyes with prior IOP-lowering therapy, corneal pathology, angle closure disease, and retinal and neurological pathology. A complete ocular examination was performed. We did a Goldman applanation tonometry and Corvus ST in random order, and those eyes with high IOP or suspicious discs also underwent an OCT and visual fields. We used the above tests and classified the 142 eyes included into the following four categories. Normals were those with IOP less than 21 with normal disc and field. Pseudoexfoliation group was similar to the normals with the addition of pseudoexfoliation deposits in the anterior segment. The next group was pseudoexfoliation eyes, which had a higher IOP but normal disc and field, and they were classified as PXF with ocular hypertension. And last were the frank PXT, which had abnormal disc and field. We use the ANOVA statistic for differentiating the means between the groups, and an ANCOVA for adjusting for the confounders. Coming to our results, the four groups were demographically similar. The clinical features are shown here. There was a significantly lower IOP, both GAT and Corvus, in the normal and PXF group compared to the other two groups. Importantly, the CCT was similar across the four groups, and the visual field parameters were worse in the PXG group compared to the other three groups. Coming to the biomechanical parameters, there were three that showed a difference across the group. The deformation amplitude was significantly higher in the normal and PXF group compared to the other two groups. That is, it was greater than one. And the A1 and A2 velocities were also significantly different across the groups. However, we know that corneal biomechanics is affected by age, CCT, and IOP. And although in our study age and CCT were similar across the groups, IOP was not. And when we plotted the GAT IOP along the x-axis and deformation amplitude across the y-axis, we saw that there was a significant association between the two. That is, as the interclock pressure increased, the deformation amplitude decreased. Therefore, we redid the analysis with an ANCOVA statistic accounting for the interocular pressure, and then found that there was no difference across the groups. So how does this compare with previous studies? There's a lot of work done on biomechanics in primary open-angle glaucoma, both using ORA and Corvus, which showed that corneal hysteresis is lower in eyes with POAG. It's also associated with glaucoma progression, and Corvus studies have shown that deformation amplitude is altered in POAG eyes. However, biomechanics in PXG is not extensively studied, and this is the first study which has established that Corvus biomechanics in eyes with PXG does not differ from normal in PXF eyes. Therefore, to conclude, one more thing about the strength of this study is that we included only treatment-naive eyes, and this is because drugs such as prostaglandins are known to affect the extracellular matrix and can result in a less stiff cornea. Again, another strength of the study was the detailed phenotyping that was used to classify the eyes with pseudoexfoliation. In conclusion, we asked the question, is weak corneal biomechanics a biomarker for glaucoma in eyes with pseudoexfoliation? And the answer was no. This is because pseudoexfoliation glaucoma is probably a high-pressure disease, and unlike POAG, corneal biomechanics has a less important role in its diagnosis and pathogenesis. Future studies should evaluate the effect of anti-glaucoma medication and IOP lowering on the Corvus ST parameters. Thank you.
Just one comment. If you're going to always do a random Goldman
this
and a non-contact, there will be because if you do a Goldman first, so always, as a clinical thing, do non-contact stuff before you want to do your Goldman.
Yes,
because
no, so
the surface would alter, and even if you do Goldman, why do you think all studies say an average of 5 readings or an average of 3 readings? Because if you do one and you do the next will usually be lower.
Yes.
Right?
So the reason we haven't done multiple readings over here, because our primary aim was not to compare the intraocular pressures.
The question is, whenever you're doing non-contact and contact,
yes,
do the non-contact first.
Yes,
don't
sir.
Randomize it. If you're going to do Goldman first and then do any of the biomechanics, you've already altered your corneal biomechanics by putting pressure once. So that's just the one point. Otherwise, good. I'm so glad somebody says that the machine is not as great as we think.
How much gap did you have between
the two measurements?
Yeah, so there was at least 1 hour.
1 hour gap.
Yes, at least 1 hour gap between the two measurements. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Zia. I think now we'll come to the keynote address. Dr. Shivani Dixit is here. No? It's okay. Then we will come to the sixth paper by the author is Sahil Thakur. Is here? Okay. Ashutosh. Sahil Thakur. Yeah. No, you have to evaluate it. Yeah. That's a selection process only is different. Actually, there is no evaluation. Actually, this is automatically selected into the this one. So you have to evaluate it. Or accept it.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for accepting my work and giving me opportunity to present it here. So the topic that we discussed was, has the tablet perimetry actually arrived, and is it kind of applicable in routine clinical practice or even for screening purposes in glaucoma patients? So we went ahead and compared an iPad app called Visual Fields Easy with the Humphrey Visual Field Analyzer in a group of glaucoma patients. So firstly, giving you a brief background of evolution of perimetry, starting from the campimeter to the arc perimeter to the bowel perimetry to automated bowel perimetry, and then better perimeters with the better standard analogs and better systems. Now we are evolving into tablet perimetry, which is what we are going to talk about. And even there has been an evolution after that into the VR-based perimeters, which can give you the complete binocular visual fields. So what we are discussing here is the tablet perimeter. The purpose was to determine if there is a correlation between the perimetric outcomes using the application on the iPad and the Humphrey Visual Field Analyzer. We included 80 subjects, 160 eyes, and we took the informed consent. Patients with vision worse than 20/40 or any recent intraocular surgery were excluded. The Visual Field Easy app is actually a supra-threshold stimulus perimeter that has a large target with high contrast. It uses a Goldman size 5 stimulus, that is 64 millimeters square. And we hypothesized that because it's a large size stimulus, thus it will have less sensitivity for detecting mild disease, but should be able to detect at least moderate and severe disease. The application tests 96 visual field locations within the central 30 degrees using a background luminance of 31.5 apostips and 16 decibel supra-threshold static perimetry target. The severity of the glaucoma patients was categorized using the Hoddap-Anderson-Parrish criteria based on the mean deviation, and the outcomes were visual field outcomes of VFE. They were compared against the HFA 24-2 CETA-FAST. So this is the brief outline how we give the patients the tablet, which has the Visual Field Easy attached. And once they do the testing, this is the count of output that the app generates. This is a printout of the output. And this is then has to be put into a computer parser, which gives us something like this. These are numbers, and it gives us parameters like false positives, false negatives, and missed points. So actually, it doesn't give us a perimetric outcome that's directly comparable to the Humphrey visual fields. So these are our results. This was our patient profile. We had 36 normal patients, 101 glaucoma eyes, and disc suspects were 23 eyes. The types of glaucoma were secondary glaucoma, NTG, POG, and PACG. The mean age was 56.19, a relatively younger age group, and 55% of them were males. In the severity criteria, we had 50% around severe, 20% moderate, and around 30% of mild patients. So when we did the analysis, the missed points on the Visual Field Easy app, this is the main outcome that Visual Field Easy app gives us, actually had a very weak correlation with the mean deviation and pattern standard deviation values. The AROC was also not that good, only 0.60 and 0.64. And the sensitivity and specificity for detecting mild glaucoma was very poor, as we had expected. However, for even moderate and severe glaucoma, it was not that good. So we went back to the literature. This is the only paper that has been published till now using this application. They had an AROC of 0.784 for moderate to advanced glaucoma versus normals. However, they also reported that for the mild glaucoma, apparently the app doesn't work that well. So thus, we concluded that the values from the VFE missed points actually have a very weak correlation, and tablet perimetry is actually still not there yet for clinical use. However, there is a new app called the Melbourne Rapid Fields. It's by the same team that developed the original app. It gives you directly the mean deviation and pattern standard deviation values. We are currently working on that as well, and probably will present results next year. The whole concept of presenting this paper was it's an idea. It's an idea that I see, and I feel that it can happen in the coming future. So you'll have people going into the periphery having these mobile adapters and devices that can take images, good images of the disc. You can take a tonopen pen and take pressures as well. You can have a tablet perimeter, have a gross idea of the of the visual fields as well, and actually follow up those patients using mobile apps. So that's the kind of future for glaucoma that I see. These are our references, and this is the current team I'm working with, and I'm thankful to them for helping me with the work. Thank you.
Are there any studies which compare it to virtual perimetry? Because that's on the same concept.
Actually, ma'am, the people that are working on virtual perimeters or the VR perimetry, they are like three or four teams that are working right now. They are comparing it to the Humphrey visual fields.
Right.
There is no comparison between tablet perimetry, VR perimetry, and Humphrey visual
so
fields.
As of now, you feel tablet perimetry, we are not there yet.
Not there yet.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
So now we move on to the next paper by Dr. Ashutosh Dayal. The title is Assessment of Psychosocial Impact of Glaucoma and Its Effect on the Quality of Life life in Patients.
Your good name, sir? Wait a moment.
Here the presenting author is not a ratified member. So we are not going to evaluate it.
So come aside.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Ashutosh Dayal from HVDSI Eye Hospital, Pune, and I'll be speaking about a study titled Assessment of Psychosocial Impact of Glaucoma and Its Effect on the Quality of Life in Patients. So coming to a brief introduction, glaucoma, as we all know, is a major cause of irreversible blindness affecting more than 60 million patients worldwide. And glaucoma basically causes peripheral visual field defects that can eventually lead to limitation of daily functioning and autonomy of the patients. Also, other factors such as adverse effect of the medications, long-term follow-ups, cost of treatment, as well as psychological impact of just knowing the diagnosis of a potentially blinding condition can adversely affect the quality of life of the patients. This can result in demotivation, low self-esteem, demoralization of the patients, which can further lead to treatment non-compliance, and that can aggravate the problem further. Hence, there is a need to quantify the effects of quality of life to customize the treatment options for patients. The aim of our study was to assess the impact of glaucoma and associated visual functional impairment on psychosocial function and quality of life of the patients. Methodology and tools, we used two tools. One was the National Eye Institute Visual Function Questionnaire, which is a self-administered questionnaire consists of 25 items that quantitatively measures the overall quality of life of the patients. Second was the Hospital Anxiety and Depression Scale, which was to analyze the clinical anxiety and depression in patients. We did a cross-sectional study on patients attending the glaucoma outpatient department at our hospital. All the patients underwent a thorough clinical examination, and those with secondary glaucomas, any other coexisting ocular condition that might have significantly impaired the vision were excluded. Hodder-Parrish-Anderson criteria was used to categorize the patients into mild, moderate, and severe categories. Patients were also classified on the basis of duration of treatment. And the patients selected were asked to respond to the questionnaires, and the response was analyzed statistically. Coming to the results, out of total 100 patients included in the study, out of 100, 59 were males, 41 were females, with a mean age of 61 years. 27 patients were on treatment for less than 1 year, 25 were on treatment for more than one but less than 3 years, while 48 were on treatment for more than 3 years. This pie chart below shows the distribution of the patient according to severity of the disease. So we can see that 44 patients, the bulk of them were having mild glaucoma as per the Hodder-Parrish-Anderson criteria. 32 were falling into moderate category and 24 had severe disease. Now here we see the mean composite NEI VFQ score. So the maximum is 100 and minimum is 0 for this particular questionnaire. We can see for the total sample size it was 72, the mean score. And if we compare to different severity of disease, mild, moderate, and severe, we see progressive decline of the score as the disease severity progresses. And this decline was statistically significant. Coming to this chart shows all the different subscales that we measure in the NEI VFQ questionnaire scores. These are all different functions that are measured. So we saw that these three points in the red, that means the driving, the role difficulty, as well as the mental health, these three were the maximally impaired for all the patients, whereas social functioning and the color vision were minimally impaired. Females had a better composite score than males. On HADS scoring, we found that 8 patients were diagnosed with clinical depression, 8 had anxiety, and 14 had both anxiety and depression. We also tried to evaluate the effect of treatment on quality of life and mental health, so we found that all the three groups of patients had low composite and mental health scores, and there was no statistical difference between the three groups. That means all three had similar impairment of the quality of life and mental health scores. Coming to discussion part, glaucoma, as we all know, is second leading cause of blindness with more than 12 million patients in India itself. Now, this disease has silent progression and potential blindness as a complication. Hence, there has been a social stigma and fear associated with the disease. Disease progression leads to loss of peripheral visual fields that may affect the daily functioning and can lead to dependency in advanced stages. This was demonstrated by worsening of quality of scores as with the disease progression. Also, we also found that the recently diagnosed patients had impaired quality of life and mental health scores, and there was no significant difference in the scores among the three categories of the patients. This was also shown in a study done by Ortberg and colleagues in 2001, where they found that there was negative psychological emotions reported by almost 80% of the patients with recent diagnosis of glaucoma. So this was attributed to lack of comprehension of disease and fear of potential blindness. And when those patients were taken for psychological counseling, they showed improvement in the psychological scores. So this fact should be borne in mind while treating patients who are newly diagnosed cases of glaucomas, that they can also have negative psychological effect. 30% patients were diagnosed with anxiety and depression, and they required psychological counseling. And studies have shown that benefits of this motivational psychological counseling, and these benefits can be in the form of increased confidence, improved psychological scores, and better treatment compliances. This highlights the need for adjuvant psychological and motivational counseling, along with the vocational therapy as part of disease management. So here we conclude that assessment of quality of life actually would help in adopting a holistic approach in individualizing treatment options for the patients. And we advise that this assessment should be done in all patients of glaucoma. Secondly, periodic psychological assessment of patients and creating awareness in the patient as well as among the family members of the patient about the disease should be included as an integral part of the disease treatment program, so that the relatives and the patient keeps themselves motivated and they follow the treatment protocol as advised to them. And other measures such as low vision aid rehabilitation for advanced cases, as well as vocational therapy can be used for advanced cases, and that may help in providing patients with better quality of life, improving their self-esteem and confidence. These are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ashutosh. Now we'll go on to the next free paper, that is systemic factors associated with optic disc hemorrhage in patients with primary glaucoma, and the presenting author is Dr. Mayur Rokde.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Dr. Mayur Rokde. I'm from Aravind Eye Hospital, Coimbatore. My AOS number is R188800. as we all know, in a glaucomatous eye, a disc hemorrhage is a sign of alarm and indicates that a disease is active and progressing. It is also an important indicator for early diagnosis of glaucoma. So our aim was to evaluate which all systemic factors are associated with the incidence of optic disc hemorrhage in the primary glaucoma. We conducted a cross-sectional study in association with a cardiologist. We had 34 eyes of 33 patients as a sample size. These are our inclusion criteria. We included all the primary glaucomas, open angle closure, OHT and NTG. These are the other inclusion criteria. Our exclusion criteria included any and all conditions which could have caused secondary glaucomas and or could have masked or mimicked primary glaucomas. When the patients with primary glaucoma who were on adequate control showed fresh disc hemorrhage showed up, we evaluated their visual acuity, anterior segment examination. This included gonioscopy as well as instantaneous GAT. Then we went ahead with the HFA 24-2 visual fields admitted them for diurnal hourly IOP monitoring. Subsequently, patients were sent to the cardiologist where they were fitted with a 24-hour ambulatory BP monitor and glycemic and cardiac evaluation was done. Coming to the results and discussions, in our study, 9 patients were there who showed loss of the normal. There are 2 normal dips, so 9 patients showed loss of normal nocturnal dipping in their blood pressure variation and 5 patients were there who showed a dip in the both normal and diurnal nocturnal dips. So a statistically significant P value was found for the presence of abnormal BP fluctuations in a fresh DH case. Out of these patients, 16 patients were on oral antihypertensive medications, and according to the physicians, all of them were well controlled. When we compared the presence of abnormal BP fluctuations, they were also showed statistically significant association with the presence of with the maximum control of BP with antihypertensive medications. Another important finding in our study was that diastolic ocular perfusion pressure fluctuation was affected significantly by diastolic BP fluctuation. However, other fluctuations in systolic and mean arterial BP, as well as systolic ocular perfusion pressure, diastolic ocular perfusion pressure, and mean ocular perfusion pressure, did not have any significant association with the presence of loss of normal patterns of BP. Okay. 28 patients showed a subnormal mean ocular perfusion pressure fluctuation, but still they had no significant associated correlation with abnormal BP dipping. Cardiac glycemic and glycemic factors had no correlation with the presence of disc hemorrhage. Similar studies were conducted by Rafael Fornanetto et al, and they observed that there was a positive association between disc hemorrhage and low MOP, low mean arterial ocular perfusion pressure. So in view of these observations, we predicted that pathogenesis and incidence of disc hemorrhage has a positive association with low mean arterial BP fluctuation as well. As we know, disc hemorrhages are considered as indicators of glaucomatous optic nerve damage. Yet we found that many patients who had adequately controlled IOP and BP both showed up with fresh disc hemorrhages. And at that time, there was no other study which had considered these factors in association with the incidence of disc hemorrhages. So a statistically significant association of abnormal BP fluctuations with lower mean ocular perfusion pressure, despite maximal IOP control, was present. And daily diastolic blood pressure fluctuation could also be a contributing factor to the incidence of DH, but it was it needed further analysis, which was not possible at that time. Mean IOP fluctuations, cardiac status, carotid blood flow, and glycemic status were of no significant statistical association. Thank you. These are my references. Any questions, please?
Sorry, I must have missed it. Did you have a control group of similar glaucoma without disc hemorrhage?
No, ma'am. No, we didn't have it.
Because all your results and conclusions say lower. So lower than glaucoma without disc hemorrhage would have made sense.
We didn't have a control group, ma'am.
Lower than normal. A normal person does not have glaucoma either.
Yes.
So
No, sir. We had this was a cross-sectional study.
So one picked up patients with patients without a disc hemorrhage.
Maybe
one more thing. Yes, when you did the ambulatory blood pressure, you said there was loss of the normal
loss
dip.
Of dipping. Yeah, there are two normal dips. One is diurnal and one is nocturnal. When there is a loss of dip, that is abnormal. When there is no dip.
Okay. So these
abnormal
findings are a little different from some studies like say normal tension glaucoma,
yeah,
where we say that the incidence of disc hemorrhage is more, and actually it is attributed to the actual dip in the when the blood pressure goes very low.
Yeah, but
that is so it's little different from what other studies show. Right?
In our study, we did not have any NTG or OHT patient, and we had 3 angle closure cases. Rest all were open angle cases, so probably that could be the contributing.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Can we next move on to next paper? Assessment of impact of Goldman apprehension tonometer on central corneal thickness. Paper 8, presented Dr. Aditi Nair.
Aditi?
Good afternoon, everyone. So today my topic is assessment of impact of
your
government.
Your IOS number, please.
Sir, I'm a member. I'll give you the number.
Okay.
Assessment of impact of Goldman Applanation tonometry on central corneal thickness. So introduction, the most important risk factor for glaucoma is elevated intraocular pressure. Accurate intraocular pressure measurement is essential for disease detection and patient follow-up. So as per the ocular hypertension treatment study, thinner CCT is an independent risk factor for glaucoma and its progression. So according to a study done by Steen et al., thin corneas produce underestimation of IOP up to 4.9 millimeters of mercury, and thick corneas can overestimate it by up to 6.8 millimeters of mercury. So CCT measurement guides us on an aggressiveness of glaucoma treatment and prevent overtreatment. In practice, thus CCT becomes a very important parameter in glaucoma diagnosis and management. This brings us to a very pertinent question, especially when one is seeing general and glaucoma patients both in a busy OPD. Is it logical to insist that all CCT measurements be taken before applanation tonometry? This study aims to find scientific answers to this question. So aim of this study was to assess impact of Goldman applanation tonometry on central corneal thickness measurement. It was a prospective study conducted over 3 months at Isha Netralaya Kalyan Maharashtra. We had used RTView XR100 OCT, and all the IOP measurements were taken on Goldman's applanation tonometry. We have used a pair t-test for statistical analysis. So all patients who presented to our clinic aged between 18 to 75 years were included in the study. And subjects with any corneal disease, intraocular inflammation, corneal scar, poor fixation, and using anti-glaucoma medication for more than 1 month were excluded from the study. So first, all patients underwent central corneal thickness measurement on RTView OCT. This was done by the same trained technician. Within 5 minutes, intraocular pressure was recorded with Goldman's applanation tonometer after instilling one drop of topical anesthetic. All measurements were recorded with the same tonometer on the same slit lamp by the same glaucoma consultant. Patient was instructed to blink normally, and within 5 minutes, central corneal thickness measurement was taken again. So OptoView RTView, it measures pachymetry by non-contact method. Axial resolution is 5 microns, transverse resolution is 15 microns, and depth resolution is 5 millimeter. It uses diode laser for its laser interferometry. So it takes 70,000 A scans per second, and it has a cornea anterior module which helps in anterior segment imaging by taking 6 millimeter scans of cornea for pachymetric analysis. The high scan speed minimizes the effect of eye movement during data acquisition, which improves the repeatability of pachymetry maps. So our sample size was 60 eyes of 30 subjects. Mean age of the sample was 51.33 years. CCT prior to GAT was mean was 498.65, and mean CCT after GAT was 495.18. Mean GAT was 14.7 millimeters of mercury. So after the analysis, we observed that there was a statistical significant difference in the corneal thickness before and after Goldman applanation tonometry. However, as you can see, that the difference between the two means, that is pre-CCT GAT and post-CCT GAT, pre-GAT and post-GAT is only 3 microns. So a previous study done by Porjavan S. et al. Reported mean CCT measurement before and after tonometry was 565.22 and 566.04, respectively. This study showed that the sequence of examination of applanation and pachymetry is not important. In another study done by J.W. Branch et al., corneal thickness following tonometry remained stable within 5 microns for 38 out of 43 participants and within 10 microns for all participants. In both of these studies, ultrasonic pachymeter was used. In our study, difference in mean CCT values before and after GAT is in agreement with the previous studies. However, in our study, difference in CCT measurements is statistically significant. We have used OCT. So some believe that CCT measurement that GAT might be influenced by microerosions of the epithelium surface or its desquamation. To the best of our knowledge, no other study has compared pachymetry with non-contact method like OCT before and after GAT. So conclusion, we conclude that for most accurate measurement of CCT using non-contact technique, it is best to do CCT measurement before applanation tonometry. These are my references. Thank you. Yes, ma'am, it is 5 microns.
So if the difference is less than the resolution of the machine, how valid is that?
Yeah, ma'am, actually we went into it. Why did we get a result like this? So out of 60 eyes, there were at least...
The resolution is 5 microns, which means right. It can differentiate right. 5 microns reliably.
Right.
So two standard deviations more is what you would take as a norm. Right. If you have a 7 to 8 micron on the OCT, you would take a 10 micron difference as
right.
any
right.
So anything less than 10 microns in this machine would not be a meaningful difference.
Yes.
So
but
I think the conclusion should have been that there was no significant difference in the CCT after
Goldman. So ma'am, actually we pondered over the conclusion, but when I went through the data, maybe the sample size is too small also. So out of 60 eyes, there were 6 patients who had who had fluctuation of around 20 microns. So that becomes significant for that particular patient.
In 3 patients, all right.
Yeah.
The second comment is whenever you're doing a study like this and you want to write it up,
yeah.
it's never going to be 60 eyes of 30 patients.
Right.
Because both eyes are going to behave
similar.
Absolutely similar.
Right.
It has to be 30 eyes of 30 patients or 60 eyes of 60 patients. You have to take one eye
okay.
per subject whenever
okay.
you're doing a comparison.
Okay, thank you.
You said the difference was
3
microns.
Yeah, we took a mean of pre-GAT CCT and post-GAT CCT. The difference between the mean of these two groups was, these two readings was 3 microns. Just hypothesis.
Speaker will be Jaya Kaushik. Is there? Yes. We'll be presenting about AGV and FACO emulsification with IOL implementation under Simab in refractory uveitis glaucoma.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Colonel Jaya Kaushik, Associate Prof, Department of Ophthalmology, AFMC, Pune. My membership number is K12383. My topic is concurrent AGV and phaco emulsification with posterior chamber IOL implantation under infliximab cover in refractory uveitic glaucoma. Why this topic was chosen? Because the refractory uveitic glaucoma, it's usually associated with one of the systemic autoimmune diseases, and the conditions are commonly associated with ocular features which are known to have recurrences, and the uveitis is recalcitrant and glaucoma is refractory, which is very difficult to manage medically. The issues involved in managing these cases are multifactorial. The medical management is ineffective. There are recurrences of non-resolving uveitis after surgical management. The prolonged inflammation after surgery may lead to failure of conventional glaucoma surgical management. How to overcome this problem? There is a literature showing perioperative control of uveitis, with the use of infliximab as immunosuppressive in cataract extraction combined with trabeculectomy in Behçet's disease. With this background, the aim of presentation of my paper is to emphasize the importance of holistic management and to evaluate the outcome of concurrent AGV with phaco emulsification with PCIOL under infliximab as an immunosuppressive. This is a prospective interventional case series. 36 eyes of 36 patients with refractory uveitic glaucoma underwent surgery with an IV infliximab cover from duration of 2007 to 2011, as the inclusion criteria was the uveitis, which is uncontrolled, the uncontrolled refractory glaucoma with IOP more than 21 millimeter of mercury with on a maximum anti-glaucoma medication, visually significant complicated cataract, and at least minimum 3 months of quiescence before surgery. The exclusion criteria included corneal or other ocular disorders. The method included HLA typing for specific diseases, comprehensive ophthalmic examination, visual charting by Snellen's chart, slit lamp evaluation, gonioscopy, the CCT, fundus by 90D, IOP measurement by GAT, and biometry by IOL master. The success outcome measures included success rate if IOP found to be less than 21 millimeter of mercury with or without any glaucoma medication, mean number of anti-glaucoma medication, visual acuity, gain in visual acuity, and various intraoperative and post-operative complications. The surgical technique of the combined surgery included the the stay suture at the cornea, followed by subconjunctival injection of lignocaine. There was phonic-based deep subconjunctival pocket to accommodate the AGV superotemporally. Subsequently, mitomycin was also used. The AGV-FP7 valve was used in all the cases. The priming of AGV is very important, done with 27 gauge needle. 7-0 proline suture is being implanted in the anterior end of the holes given. the distance between limbus to the site of AGV is around 7 to 8 millimeter above the limbus. Partial thickness pocket, scleral pocket, is being made with a crescent knife, and the tube is being implanted into the entered into the anterior chamber by 23 gauge needle, and the tube is being sutured with the anchoring sutures. Subsequently, it is followed by the cataract surgery as a conventional phacoemulsification. The result of my studies were, there were 36 patients, 24 male and 12 male females. The mean age was 37 years. The most common diagnoses were idiopathic Behçet's disease, followed by recurrent chronic anterior uveitis and ankylosing spondylitis. The mean interval time period between the last attack of uveitis was 3 to 9 months. The outcome was, there was improvement in visual acuity from 20 by 125 to hand movement close to face preoperative to 20 by 14, 18 of the patients. There were 4 patients in which they had a total glaucomatous optic atrophy, and rest of the patient there was persistent vitritis. The vision could not be regained after the surgery. The average IOP was 37.8 plus minus 11.67 millimeter of mercury preoperative, which was improved to 24 eyes at 2 years follow-up. The 2 eyes underwent cyclodestructive procedure due to uncontrolled IOP. The mean number of anti-glaucoma medication also reduced from 4 to up to none or 1 or 2 medication in 2 years follow-up. These are some of the pictures of the post of follow-ups. The difficulty faced in our study was the intraoperative challenges due to meiotic pupil, floppy iris, presence of synechia, sticky cortical plate. There was post-operative challenges also in presence of the patient had choroidal effusion, there was tube blockage, and persistent low-grade vitritis. So advantages of combining AGV with phaco was one-stage procedure and simultaneous surgical IOP control with visual rehabilitation. The limitation of study was, study had few limitations with lesser number of subjects, lack of randomization, and absence of control. To conclude, combined AGV with phacoemulsification with PCIOL implantation is an effective method for controlling uveitic glaucoma with significant complicated cataract. Thank you.
Dr. Jaya, just one question. I think the primary outcome which I would be interested in would be the incidence of the uveitic attacks following. So could you control uveitis? That is the question. I mean, you put in a tube, you do a cataract surgery, the pressures we expect would be less. What is the story of the uveitis?
Ma'am, we had to give most of the patient, we had to keep them under follow-up. We had given them at 0 day infliximab, followed by at the 2 weeks, then 6 weeks, and then we had to call them, depending on the presence of uveitis, we had to give them again the infliximab post-operatively.
So that's the question. Suppose we had just given our routine prednisolone as we do, 1 milligram per kg, pre-op, and then follow it up for at least 3 months and then taper. So does this new modality, you need to compare it to standard practice?
Yes, ma'am.
So
that
was,
we could have
was uveitis better controlled with infliximab because it's an expensive drug?
Yes, ma'am.
So and subjecting them to that cost you have to tell us that it was a better controlled uveitis, because 12 pressures in a post-uveitic eye could well be due to reactivation of uveitis.
Yes, ma'am. There was persistent vitritis in many of the patients. That is why some of the them could not regain visual acuity post-operatively.
So that's why with our uveitis load being what it is, I'd be very interested in knowing whether infliximab cost is well worth it or the prednisolone.
Yes. Only the side effects of IV methyl prednisolone and the systemic steroids are not there with the infliximab.
Your outcome,
yes.
Right? Mm. What is the incidence of uveitis? Were the side effects better? Mm-hmm. Suppose I had taken a group of standard care methyl pred. Is infliximab the better thing to do, or is it equivalent?
One more question. Did you encounter any tenensis formation in your series? Tenensis formation post-operatively
no,
in your
we
series?
We didn't found any tenensis. We didn't found any, we didn't get any scleral thinning or anything in any of our patients.
And any systemic complications with infection?
Ma'am, we were following them up for their platelet count, their LFT and RFT.
And monitoring and managing.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. All cases were managed under supervision of rheumatologist as well as pathologist and the ophthalmologist. It was a holistic management.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
The last paper, that is paper 10, that is optic nerve sheath diameter in glaucoma patients and its correlation with intraocular pressure. But however, the presenting author is not a ratified member. Is it allowed?
Because she missed her flight, so I requested Dr.
Lalit
Verma, and he said he
and
you are a ratified.
Yeah, all right, then we will
evaluate
it.
She's name?
She's Dr.
Shalini
Mishra.
Dr.
Shalini
Mishra.
Good afternoon, Chair. And dear members, I'm going to present this paper on optic nerve sheath diameter in glaucoma patients and its correlation with intraocular pressure. I don't have any financial disclosure. We know that optic nerve sheath is an anatomical extension of the dura mater, and so is the subarachnoid space around the optic nerve. Now, this is because of this, the CSF is also in continuity with the rest of the central nervous system, which is there around the optic nerve also. Now, the lamina cribrosa is actually a barrier between the intraocular space and retrobulbar space of the optic nerve. The diameter of optic nerve sheath is 1.6 millimeter within the nerve. In the orbit, it is 3.5, and in intracranial space, it is 4.5 millimeter. Now, if we focus on this diagram, then we see that translamina cribrosa pressure difference, this is actually intraocular pressure minus CSF. So if intraocular pressure is high, it will push the lamina cribrosa posteriorly if the CSF pressure is on the lower side, and then it will cause more of glaucoma progression. And in such a scenario, if CSF pressure is low, even if IOP is normal, there will be glaucomatous damage. And this was the basis of our study. The optic nerve sheath diameter can be measured by ultrasound, CT scan, and MRI. The aims and objective of the study was to study the optic nerve sheath diameter in the patients of POAG, PACG, NTG, and controls, and compare these values with age and sex match controls, and then correlate these parameters with intraocular pressure. This was a hospital-based cross-sectional study done at a tertiary care eye center. These were the inclusion criteria. All the patients, newly diagnosed patients of POAG, PACG, and NTG were taken. Exclusion criteria, any other cause of secondary glaucoma were excluded, or patient who underwent any kind of surgery on the eye were excluded from the study. The clinical examination was done along with detailed history. A written informed consent was taken as per Helsinki's declaration. CCT, intraocular pressure, angle was seen with gonio lenses. Visual field was measured on Humphrey's visual field analyzer. And this photograph was taken, and ONSD was measured by B scan and CT scan. Now, this was the method to measure the optic nerve sheath diameter. It was taken 3 millimeter behind in the optic nerve in the axial section, where there is more likelihood of dilatation of this optic nerve sheath diameter. So these are the results. We had 38 patients of POAG, 32 patients of PACG, 18 patients of NTG, and 48 controls. Mean age was almost same. Mean intraocular pressure was 27 in POAG, 49 in PACG, NTG patient had 16, control had 15. This was the optic nerve sheath diameter in ultrasonography, which was around a value of 5 millimeter in NTG, and rest were below 4.5 millimeter. Similarly, on CT scan, also the mean optic nerve sheath diameter in NTG patients was around 5 millimeter, and rest were below 4.5 millimeter. This was the correlation between the nerve sheath diameter in ultrasound and CT scan. It had a positive correlation. And the correlation between intraocular pressure and ONSD showed that there was a positive, mild positive correlation in PACG patients, but rest of the patient had no significant correlation. So optic nerve sheath diameter was widest in patients of NTG in comparison to POAG, PACG and controls. And there was a mild correlation of intraocular pressure in PACG, and it was significantly increased in the patients of NTG. So the conclusion was drawn that optic nerve sheath diameter measurement can be a useful tool in diagnosing NTG patients. As in early stages, there can be dilatation of ONSD of 5 mm or more. A TLCPD difference can give an insight into the pathophysiology of glaucoma, especially the NTG patients. And therefore, this investigation can tell us about the pathophysiology and can also be a tool in assessing the progression of disease of these patients. Thank you so much for your kind attention. What we used to do, we used to make the patient lie supine, and then with closed eyes, we asked the patient to focus on her or his thumb so that he or she directly sees upwards. And then we took the axial section, and after that, the image was, then the 3 millimeter behind the posterior wall, it was measured. Axial section. No, if we take maximal diameter, then the length might vary. Then how we will compare? Now, if we take at a fixed distance, then only we can compare with other patients. Yeah. Ultrasound and CT scan both were used to assess the diameter on CT scan also, and it correlated well with our ultrasound findings. Now there is a study in that case with MRI patients. Now, because in MRI patients, generally what happens, the patient are laid prone position, and so there is generally a reverse kind of picture which is there in MRI. So nowadays MRI is not compared with the readings of ultrasonography and CT scans. So that is kept as a separate entity, and ultrasonography and CT scan are kept as a separate entity. It is because of the position of the patient which is specific in MRI.
Just one question. We assume that a wider optic nerve sheath diameter would have a lower CSF pressure. What is the assumption? That your introduction was all about the translaminar pressure, and then you said that in NTG probably the translaminar pressure is higher because the CSF pressure is low. But we are measuring optic nerve diameter. So are we assuming?
Yeah, yeah. Because it is actually, we cannot cannulate every patient of NTG. So it is a kind of assumption, and studies have shown that in these patients, the diameter is more because CSF pressure is more. So that is why it is an assumption that if we find more of diameter of optic nerve sheath diameter, so the CSF pressure is more in those patients. So that is why we have measured CSF pressure and the diameter.
And your optic nerve sheath diameter was most in PAG?
No, NTG.
NTG. So in NTG, the CSF pressure is less. That's why the translaminar pressure is more. And that's why you have glaucoma.
Exactly.
Transconial pressures, which are normal, because the CSF pressure is lower.
Now, ma'am, in fact, there are so many studies that are coming up that in NTGs, the CSF pressure is more, but diameter is also more. And in fact, recently also there is a published study which shows similar kind of results. So it is a kind of contrary findings that we were thinking in the lines that because CSF pressure is more, so diameter should be more and vice versa. But here the thing is that when we cannulate those patients and we measure CSF pressure, it is on the lower side. But when we measure the optic nerve sheath diameter, it is on the higher side. Thank you.
So here we come to the conclusion of this free paper session. I will announce the results here.
We'll hand over.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you all for attending the session.